One of the things that can be really helpful whenever you're going to be creating a GUI is to actually get the code working independently of the GUI. So for example, I just typed guide. So it's very, very tempting to just get started and say, okay, I know what I want to do. So I want to create a plot where I'm going to like have little targets. I'm going to pretend there's a cannon here, and then the cannon's going to go shoot this target. So I know that I'm going to have an input of the velocity of the cannon, and I know I'm going to have an input of the speed, or wait, that's the same thing, of the angle of the cannon. So I'm going to go ahead and label those. So I'm going to have velocity. So remember, I can double click and I can say, oops, not that. Velocity. And it doesn't really matter what that's called. This is going to be my velocity one. So I'm going to relabel it blank. And its tag is going to be an edit velocity, because it's an editable text box. So I call it edit velocity. This one's going to be the angle, so I can call this one edit angle, edt angle. So velocity, angle, and you're so excited because you're making this GUI, right? And then blah. And then I'm going to have a button, and you're going to hit the button, and it's going to say fire. You're so excited because, like, look at all this progress you've made. You're like, yay. Okay, so I'll make this bigger. And see, look at me. I'm like amazing, and I've got this GUI. And unfortunately, now I have to actually write code to do it. So what ends up happening is you get so excited, and you build this GUI, and then the logic isn't there. Now, I kind of know what I'm doing, so I kind of built this the way it needed to go. But, you know, you get so involved in, like, you know, moving stuff and making it, like, where it needs to be and lining things up and making them the right color. I'll see. I have to do this, and then blah. Okay, so it's all good, and you're so excited. But then when you start to write the code, then things go south very, very, very quickly. So this is actually something I want to... Oh, I changed it to a push button because I'm an idiot. So theoretically, I can go in here and I can do the callbacks and I can start writing all of the code from here. So I'm going to call this ready, aim, fire, because that's what my book tells me to call it. Okay. So anyway, so I can go ahead and I can do this. One of the problems, though, is a lot of times we get so deeply involved in what's going on with the GUI that we kind of forget what the basic code is. So I'm actually going to close out my ready, aim, fire thingy. And there, I'm just going to close this. It's still there, so it's okay. But I want to write the script first and see if I can get the script to work. So basically what I want to have is I want to have the user input a velocity, and I'm going to have the user input an angle, and then I want to shoot the cannon from the left, from the origin, toward a target. And I don't have a target yet, but that's okay. I just want to shoot toward a non-existent target. Okay. All right. So I guess part of the point is whenever you're building a GUI, sometimes you have to build things straight within the GUI, but a lot of times, like the little bits and pieces of logic, you can go right off to the side as a script and then import the script once you've actually got it working so that you know that the problem isn't with the... So that if it's working outside the GUI, then you know your problem is interfacing with the GUI, not with the logic itself. This is really like the best piece of advice I could give you if you're trying to do stuff with a GUI. So we're just going to start off, and I don't even want to bother having the user input an angle and velocity, so I'm just going to call something. Velocity is 30, and angle is 25, and we're going to assume this is in degrees. Okay, so whenever I'm trying to think about how I want this to work, I'm going to say, okay, well, let's see. I want to set a time, and I don't know exactly how long it's going to take, but I can go ahead and I can say, all right, let's just select the time. So what we're going to use is we're going to use the two kinematic equations, which is that x is equal to, oh goodness, initial velocity. So this is x equals v plus, thank you, I know that, velocity times time plus 1/2 at squared. So it's really initial or x squared plus b naught. Okay, so this theoretically should be, this isn't the real equation I'm going to use, but this should look like a maybe physics equation that you've seen before. Initial position times, or plus initial velocity times time plus 1/2 at squared. Maybe, yes? Okay. So, and it's really initial velocity in the x direction. So I don't know how you write this in actual non-subscript, superscript speak. But basically you're doing x is equal to x naught plus v in the x direction, initial times time, 1/2 at squared. So my x position, well, my initial is 0. I could say, well, my x component of velocity is going to be the velocity times the cosine. Cosine in degrees of the angle times time. So remember, because the initial velocity in the x direction is cosine, because that's, you know, vectors and stuff. Plus 1/2. Now acceleration, and again, this is acceleration in the x direction. I actually don't have any acceleration in the x direction, so I could just say 0 times t squared, or times squared. So actually I don't need that last term, but it's just there because, you know, physics, and it should be there. And then you should just remember that there's no velocity, there's no acceleration in the x direction. And the y component is gonna look just the same. So it's gonna look just like this, except everywhere there's an x, it's gonna say y. So it's my initial y position plus my initial velocity in the y direction times time plus 1/2 times the acceleration in the y direction times t squared. So my y initial position is 0. Velocity now is going to be sine, and then 1/2, and now in this case, gravity is negative, what am I in, feet per second? Sure. Not feet per second, meters per second. Negative 9.81 meters per second squared times time squared. Okay, so I have my x and y positions. So we're actually going to go ahead, and we haven't defined time yet, and so we'll just go ahead and randomly pick. We'll just assume that it's going to go from 0 to 100, and let's give ourselves, like, I don't know, like 1,000 points. So that way we're, you know, we've got like a really nice line that's not going to be chunky. So there we go. Now we have this opportunity to plot this. So what we'd like to do is let's just go ahead and plot x and y to begin with, okay? And see what this looks like. Okay. So that's lovely, okay? So we go crash, okay? So basically, really I don't need most of this because all I need is this little section, like, right there. It's really hard to see what's going on because these are so big. All right, so let's not go so far out for these particular example. Let's try it like this. There we go. Now you can see a little bit of an arc, and I'm still got way too much time on here. So I could go like that, and do this again, and my little figure thing there. Okay, so now I can see that this is a nice little spot and a nice little arc. So that's kind of the arc that I'm looking for. Okay. Beautiful. I'm excited. Okay. I kind of need to solve the problem that I've got really super negative values. So there's a couple of ways I could do this. I could look and see, really what I want to see is I want to know when is this going to go negative. So let's do that. Let's find where the y value is going to be greater than 0. Or is going to be, yeah, let's just find all the ones where it's greater than 0. So we'll call these good values, is where we're going to find y greater than or equal to 0. And let's just plot. I'm just going to print these out so you can see what these are. So remember what the find function does, is the find function actually gives us the indices, gives us the index values of the arrays that we're interested in. So basically it's saying that the first, for this case, the first 517 values are the ones that we want. Okay, so those are the good values, or the good indices, or whatever. So what we can say is, well, really what we want is the good y's are y at those values, and the good x's are the x's at those values. And instead of plotting x and y, we can plot good x's and good y's. And let's see if that works. Okay. So there we go. So that what that actually did is it only plotted the values that are within the range that we're looking for. Okay. So we can go ahead and we can have a whole lot of time on here, because if I change, what did I have it on? I had it on like 5 or something. So if I have like this super, super high velocity at some relatively low angle, so now I don't have enough time. Okay, so we're only really on the very, very top part of that that velocity. So we're still going up. So I'm going to go ahead and just do a whole bunch of these, and it doesn't matter. I'm going to do a whole bunch to show you something. So I'm going to do a whole bunch, and theoretically it's not going to matter, because I'll have enough values for this to work. So let's run this again. And so I did that, and now my picture is all chunky. And you're like, well, that's really stupid. Why do I have a chunky picture? And that's because I don't have enough points. So maybe instead of doing a lens space, I want to say that, well, I'm going to go ahead and do a lens space, but right now you see the way that this works. So I'll go ahead and print that out for you so you can see. I'll start with the CLC clear. Okay. Oh, it's really hard to tell. Well, basically I have more points or less points than I have as a range. So what I could do to kind of fix this is, instead of using a lens space, I want to say I specifically want a step value of, say, like a tenth of a second. I want to go up to a whole lot of seconds. So there. So basically that's going to say, I'm going to start at 0. I'm going to go up by, say, a tenth up to whatever that is, like a million or something like that. And now if I run this, it might take a little bit longer, but there we go. So now I've got this really nice arc, and it's going to be beautiful. So I'm going to change my values back to something, I guess, a little bit more reasonable. And there. And that still looks good. If I really wanted, I could add more fidelity to the picture. Why are you not like actually landing? I'll bet you it's because you don't go to 0. So let me make this a little bit smaller. And I'm going to run it again. Okay. So now I've got enough fidelity to actually get all the way to the ground. But it did take a little bit longer. But that's okay. I got time. Okay. So I've actually got code working now. Now it's time to start making my GUI. I don't want to start making my GUI until I get decent code working. I can't emphasize this enough. I don't want to start working on my GUI until I have some kind of functional code. So even if it seems like something simple that's going on, take it outside, kind of work it up, get it working, get it making sense, and then go ahead and put it into your GUI. So I'm going to open up the ReadyAimFire GUI. So I have this GUI already made. Here's all the code. I think I've said before, I like to put a CLC at the beginning, the opening function, just because it clears out the command window. It's not going to kill out the workspace, but it does clear out the command window. Everything else is good. So this is the push button callback. So this is where I actually want to start doing stuff. So basically, I'm going to take the code that I have, and I'm not going to change anything, except for I'm not going to have to clear on it. I'm just going to put this in here, and it should run this whenever I hit that button. So I have changed absolutely nothing, because I really want to know what's going on. I really want to know what the problems are. And if this doesn't work in the GUI and it worked outside the GUI and I changed nothing, then that means I've got bigger problems to solve. Okay, so I'm going to run this somehow. So I'm not going to enter anything. I'm just going to click the button, and hopefully it's going to think about it. Yay! Okay, so I've actually got this now. So this is really, really awesome. I've got enough data to, this is working, so now I can actually start interacting with my GUI and see what it's going to do. Okay, phenomenal. I'm going to actually make a little bit less values here, because that was kind of ridiculous. It did take a while. Oh, that was a lot faster. Okay. All right. Now what I'd like to do is, instead of having a set velocity and a set angle, I'd like to go ahead and get the information from the GUI of what that angle and velocity are going to be. So I'm going to right click that figure. I'm going to open it in guide. And I'm going to remember what I call these things. Oh, really? You're going to do me like that? That's not helpful. All right. Stupid. All right, so there we go. So the velocity, where they're going to put the velocity, I called edit velocity. And the angle, where they're going to put the angle, I called edit angle. Okay, that's all I need to know. Okay, so I'm going to get out of this. So now, instead of having velocity equal to 30, I'm going to specifically say that velocity I'm going to get from the edit velocity, I'm going to get what is currently in the string function. Okay, so I'm going to say go to edit velocity and go to the string function. Now, it doesn't always necessarily find edit velocity on its own, so I'm going to tell it it's within the handles structure. So there's a structure that has all of the GUI data in it, and it automatically comes to this function. So I'm going to tell it handles.editVelocity string. So I want you to go to handles.editVelocity, and I want you to get whatever is there in the string. Now, the only thing that I really need to be careful about is the fact that this is automatically going to be returned as a string instead of as an actual number. So I need to string to num it in order to turn that into an actual numerical value. Otherwise, I'm going to get something weird off the ASCII table. The same thing for the angle. I'm going to say I want to get from handles.editAngle, I want you to give me the string property. Okay. And then on top of that, I want you to go to string to num. Why do you not like string to num? Oh, string to double is faster. I don't care. So there we go. So theoretically now, that should work. So we'll try. So I'm going to put in a velocity of 30 and an angle of 25, which are the same numbers I had before. Hit fire, and it works! This is so very, very, very exciting. It's really hard to get more awesome than that. Woot! So let's say that you've got that working, and then we'll do more in another video, because that seems like it's totally worthy of a full video right there.